Live from downtown Detroit, home of WDIV and Click on Detroit, Local 4 News at Noon starts now.
Voting day yesterday, we're looking at some key races and results and which communities do and do not want marijuana in their areas.
But first, what community doesn't want snow in their area? Rain and snow showers are headed right for the Metro Detroit communities, especially the ones to the north. How much we can expect. But first, we want to get to our breaking news just into our newsroom. Retired Unato Auto Workers GM Vice President Joe Ashton is charged in connection to a bribery and kickback scandal, becoming the 13th and highest ranking person charged in a years-long corruption investigation. Let's get straight out to business editor Rod Maloney, who has been following all the twists and turns with this. Bring us up to speed on the very latest.
Well, I'll tell you what, Rhonda, here's the thing. Joe Ashton is not a known name in the city of Detroit, but he has been a very powerful guy. He was the UAW GM vice president, like you said, which put him in charge of this, the Center for Human Resources here on the Detroit River near Stroh River Place. But he also was on the VEBA board. The VEBA was the healthcare trust that was created during the bankruptcy. Very important, lots of money involved in that. And that gave him a seat on the General Motors Board of Directors as the union representative. But he resigned back in 2017 from the board, and there's a reason why. We found out today. It was this indictment, and also he knew this day was coming. Joe Ashton served as UAW GM vice president from 2010 to 2014. He left the GM board in 2017. He's charged in a scheme with his two closest associates, Jeffrey Peterzik, who served as co-director of the CHR with Ashton, and then Michael Grimes, Ashton's administrative assistant. Here's how the feds say the scam worked. Ashton's chiropractor had a business whom the feds are calling Vendor B. Ashton asked Vendor B to give a $250,000 loan to a construction company Ashton knew. Vendor B gave the loan. The contractor defaulted on the note. Ashton suggested as a way to get Vendor B paid doing a custom UAW watch contract. Profits would pay off that loan, and the contract was for just under $3 million. Ashton had Jeffrey Peterzik rig the bid on the contract for $1 million more than it was worth, and then went to Vendor B and demanded kickbacks on the watch contract. The feds now say he collected $250,000 paid over several years from Vendor B, with Vendor B driving to Ashton's home to make those payoffs. Ashton made certain Vendor B cut Grimes and Peterzik in on the deal. They both have pled guilty and are awaiting sentencing. There's no date yet set for Ashton's arraignment and expected guilty plea.
Now, the United Auto Workers put out a statement just a few minutes ago saying that Joe Ashton's actions as set forth in the government's filings are completely inexcusable and violate the UAW's longstanding standards of conduct put in place by former leaders like Walter Reuther. General Motors also weighed in, saying that GM also put out a statement that GM is deeply disturbed by Joe Ashton's alleged criminal conduct. GM was not aware of this illegal activity until it was recently revealed by the government's investigation. Now, we're expecting to sit down with new UAW President Rory Gamble and hear what he has to say. We'll be talking to him this afternoon. We'll hear his words coming up on Local 4 News at 5. Reporting live in Detroit, Rod Maloney, Local 4.
Rod, thank you. Also, breaking news this noon, House Democrats schedule the first public hearings in the impeachment inquiry for the next week. Both William Taylor, acting ambassador to Ukraine, and George Kent, the deputy assistant secretary of state responsible for Ukraine, will be testifying on November 13th. Former ambassador to Ukraine Marie Yovanovitch will testify on November 15th. Closer to home, Van Buren Township police arrest a couple in connection to two robberies. It started at a Hungry Howie's. That robbery was caught on tape with the suspect pointing a gun right at two workers. We're told that the couple then robbed a Walmart store. Tamara Elam of Ypsilanti and Michael Laster of Van Buren are charged with armed robbery. Police wanted $50,000 bond for both of them. A judge decided against that, giving them personal bond, and they must wear a tether. Turning our attention now to the weather, and we need to brace ourselves to see a little bit of that white blob you have coming our way.
Not the first flakes of the season, but really the first organized system we've seen like this coming in through Livingston County, certainly leaving a little trace here on grassy surfaces and on trees. The ground a little too warm for any ice or anything like that, but Livingston County from Heartland toward Commerce Township, West Bloomfield over into Birmingham. You see more snow heading that way. But the general trend is for areas to the north. And it looks like between M59 and I-69, that's where we also have the mix possibility. It's mainly just snow trending into the areas north of I-69. We're seeing temperatures stuck in the middle 30s right now, and our better chances for a little of that wintry mix and snow down here, Rhonda, will be later tonight. So it's mainly our north zone for the next few hours. May get some accumulation.
But none of us are in the clear. All right, Brandon, thank you. It was a much later election night than expected in many Metro Detroit communities. In fact, some races were not officially decided until around midnight. Nick Monticelli has results and reaction.
Good afternoon. Obviously, a lot of key races in a lot of communities across Metro Detroit, but we're going to look at Warren, Flint, and Livonia, and also look at the communities where marijuana was on the ballot. Some were surprised by the election results, some were not.
Is that you on that tape?
No, it's more of the same.
We'll begin in Warren, where Mayor Jim Fouts has been elected to serve a fourth term as the city's mayor, despite controversy of alleged racial commentary caught on tape. For more than a year, Fouts has been saying the tapes are fake, made to disparage him during the election season. Fouts won with 57% of the vote. In Flint, a new mayor has been elected, ousting incumbent Karen Weaver, who has been at the helm during the water crisis. Sheldon A. Neely won by 205 votes, a 40-59% election. He says his priorities are already lining up.
Adding quality of life for Flint families, and we're going to continue to make sure that people focus on the important things in the community.
The city of Livonia has elected its first female mayor, although both candidates are females. Maureen Miller Brosnan, a lifetime Livonia resident, beat out Laura Toy by 164 votes. In a statement, she says, "Our campaign has laid the groundwork for a clear agenda for Livonia's future, and I am honored to be chosen to lead the city as we enact that vision." And four marijuana measures were on local ballots. Every city had some type of measure that would have allowed or increased the number of marijuana businesses. It only passed in Lincoln Park. The measures failed in Allen Park, Keego Harbor, and Walled Lake. Now, the conversation about marijuana is not over in these communities, though. City leaders saying they still have a lot of work to do to figure out what can and cannot be done because of state rules, regulations, city ordinances, and how it all plays together. I'm Nick Monticelli, Local 4.
All right, Nick, thank you. And a big race result in Ann Arbor, and we mean big to the tune of $1 billion. It's a $1 billion bond proposal for the city's school district, and it passed by 6%, so it was close. It will allow the district to replace existing school infrastructure and build new classroom space. And over in Warren, incumbent city clerk Sonia Buffa was reelected, defeating current assisting city council secretary Keith Sadowski. And over in Marysville, incumbents Kathleen Heyman and Paul Wessel retain their council seats. We have all of the finalized results for you on most of the races. You can find them right there on the homepage of clickondetroit.com.
New at noon.
Coming up, we're going live now to Sky 4, which is over downtown Detroit. And will you take a look at that? That is where the city's Christmas tree has arrived and about to be set up in Campus Martius Park. If you're wondering, the tree was cut down up in the Upper Peninsula recently and driven all the way downstate. And it is a 60-foot Norway spruce. The tree lighting will be taking place in a couple of weeks. All right, now I'm getting excited for the holidays. It always looks so beautiful downtown, all lit up. Still to come, things are definitely heating up regarding the impeachment inquiry. Who is testifying behind closed doors right now? And what key witness revised his testimony, confirming a quid pro quo with Ukraine? And later on First at 4, the Detroit Institute of Arts promised it would not ask taxpayers for more money after a 2012 millage. Now it's doing just that. Our Paula Tutman takes a look at what's changed, how much it will cost, and what people are saying about the surprising flip-flop. That's today on Local 4 News, First at 4.